Hello everybody, this is the GameBizWolf. Welcome to my channel. We are going to talk about the art and business of making games. Today we are talking about the Outer Worlds from Obsidian. Obsidian will always have a special place in my heart. The Outer Worlds is a first-person RPG based in a science fiction western setting. The developer is Obsidian, known for Grounded, great game, check it out, Pillars of Eternity, Fallout New Vegas, Neverwinter Nights, and others. So they are masters of RPG building. The publisher is Private Division, a subsidiary of Take-Two. Two DLC have been released for the game as of May 2021, and I think the second one was the last DLC. Now let's have a look at the product. If you like Fallout, you will like this one. Obsidian, they say they wanted to make a kind of Fallout meets Firefly kind of game. And the game uses the Fallout special sauce, which means it combines both dark humor and silliness. Playthrough time. I personally have played 50 hours to reach the point where I could enter the big finale, which I won't enter because then I would finish the game and I want to continue playing with the two DLC that I've now bought. Obsidian says it does make sense to replay and choose different paths in your quests, so this is an option for players. Features. You have a party management system with 6 companions, of which you can take 2 onto missions. You have an inventory where you can sort the tons of loot you find. You have weapons and armor that are both upgradable and moddable. There are 4 damage types, critical hits, armor penetration, stat bonuses on equipment, everything you can think about when you, you think about a role-playing game. This is an RPG without fixed classes. The player is free to customize a character with 18 skills that range from 0 to 100. There are 10 skill points per level, free to distribute. Every few levels there's also a new perk to choose from to further diversify your character. There's bullet time called TTD or Tactical Time Dilution. Sorry, dilation. It's rather short but allows you to examine enemies without stress and make up your mind of how you want to handle this fight. Story and setting. Your character wakes up from being frozen in a colony ship called The Hope. Reminds a little bit about Fallout, doesn't it? The story plays in one planetary system that has been colonized maybe 50 years ago. There are 5 major and 4 minor factions. 2 planets have been colonized and there are several space stations and colonized asteroids throughout the system. The mood is dark and dystopian and mixes a western flair with science fiction. The game cannot be too dark, but it still needs gravitas, and I think they hit this spot very well. The developers worked really long on with the writers on the tone of their character design, and the guiding principle was, what would real people do in such a situation? Levels. The game is played not on a huge open world, but instead on game maps of various sizes. Using the spaceship, the player travels between those maps. There are fast travel points within the maps, so traveling is straightforward and easy. Let's look at how they built the product. First, an ideation phase. Obsidian's 2 game directors, Tim Kane and Leonard Boyarsky, started a 3-month-long ideation phase. At the end, they knew they wanted to build a first-person RPG and how the setting should look like. Should feel like, I should say. After that, they started a prototyping phase of 6 months. And in March 2017, they had their first prototype. It demonstrated the combat, the stealth and the dialogue systems. Art style. The art director Daniel Alpert and his team then defined the art style. a concept artist called Bobby Hernandez made a picture of an old western style street, but with laser guns and in a setting run by 19th century style robber baron companies. And this picture was really helpful in showing everybody what the game should look and feel like. Then they created a vertical slice. This showed all aspects of the game with the features, but only on a very, very small level or small part of the game, with partly untextured gray blocks, but fully playable. After 1 year, they had an internal trailer. This was in September 2017, and this helped convey to the team what the game should be. Engine, team size, and scope. Obsidian used the Unreal Engine 4 for the first time. A lot of the tools and pipelines needed to be optimized, and expected task durations were not met. This caused the team to make a lot of cuts. The team was also not huge for such a game, and at its biggest point was only 75 people. The developers started with too much scope and had to cut a whole planet on which some people had been working for 6 months. And the cuts in the story were made early enough so to not feel disjointed, say the game directors. And I agree. They also say that they feel like they could have built the game ending a little bit better. After finishing the game, the team realized that it was smaller than expected. Since some parts were cut, they needed to rearrange, so some companion quests, for example, were moved to the game map of the asteroid Scylla, which would have been pretty empty after the cuts otherwise. Working on the largest map caused a bit of a difficulty since several teams wanted to work on it simultaneously but couldn't. For example, the lightning team could only start after the area designers were done. So let's look at the story flow and level design, which is a critical topic for a role-playing game. Obsidian defined several story choke points. For example, the first one was when the player gets his or her ship. After that, the player is pretty free to fly wherever he or she wants. This accommodates many players, but also created a lot of complexity for the dev team. They had to think about how the story should unfold and how player A with different quest choices from player B or player C would experience the story. Obsidian started with a top-down design on paper and then iterated a lot to make sure the overall story pacing made sense. Then the level design started with a gray block map. The area designers do level design and quest design and had to think, for example, about how to draw the player to a specific point of interest. After this was done, the levels were textured. Playstyles. A difficult part of this game is that it must support several playstyles. There are players who want to complete the whole game only with sneaking and stealing. There are players who want to just kill all NPCs the moment they see them. And there are players who just skip through all the text. They all must be able to complete the game and understand what's going on around them. Let's look at the publisher now. Obsidian had agreed on a publishing deal with Private Division, which is a daughter company of Take-Two. About 1 year before launch, Microsoft purchased Obsidian for $7.5 billion. This didn't change the publishing deal though, and the working relationship between the developer and the publisher finished and remained quite amicable. Since Microsoft bought Obsidian in November 2018, both Obsidian and Bethesda now belong to the Microsoft family. Fans are excited, but even if there won't be a big cooperation between the studios, some financial security is surely nice for the developers. The game was released in October 2019 for PC, PlayStation 4, Xbox One. Price was $59.99. Digital copies were sold only through the Epic Games Store and Microsoft Store for the first year. So no Steam for the first year. This only started together with GOG and other digital retailers in October 2020. I don't know what Epic paid for this, but for the developer and publisher, this is a pretty good deal since the Epic Store only takes 12% of revenue instead of 30% like Steam does. For using games, for using the Unreal Engine and the Outer Worlds is such a game, the publisher can ignore the engine royalties for games sold via the Epic Game Store, which makes sense because this is Epic's engine. So great for the developer to not pay engine fees. The engine fees are 5% for the Unreal Engine after the first $1 million gross revenue, not net, gross. Everything below that is still free, which affects smaller developers more than, let's say, Obsidian. A version for Nintendo Switch was released on June 2020 and the port was produced by Studio Virtuos, who have previously handled Switch ports for games like L.A. Noire, Dark Souls Remastered and Final Fantasy XII. Now we have May 2021, so let's have a look at the numbers. In May 2021, during a conference call of Take-Two, who owns the publisher Private Division, it was announced that The Outer Worlds has shipped 3 million units and that The Outer Worlds has exceeded their expectations, being one of the largest contributors to revenue in fiscal year 2020. That's up from 2.5 million units since last year, a bump driven by the launch of the Murder on Eridanos DLC. Which means that in these numbers, Take-Two counts the DLC as sale, no matter if you buy the DLC or the full game. If you look at Take-Two's 2020 annual report on page 30, we find that the marketing budget for all titles is about 14.8% of net revenue. We can now estimate the marketing budget for this title if we multiply it with the net revenue which has been published. Thank you. Take-Two also lists net revenue coming from The Outer Worlds as $159.8 million, which is 131 million euros for the fiscal year ending in March 2020. The annual report for 2021 is not yet out, obviously. That means we have no data between March and October 2020. When the game was released on the digital distribution platforms like Steam, these numbers are missing. We don't have them. We can only estimate. And our estimations will be very inaccurate. Now an overview of the DLC. DLC number one is called Peril on Gorgon and was released on September 2020. Still sells for $14.99. DLC number two is called Murder on Eridanos. It's the final story expansion and it's released on March 2021 and sells for $14.99. For both DLC, subscribers of Xbox Game Pass receive a 10% discount. Microsoft, good job. Both DLC together can be purchased as one package called an expansion pass, which costs then $24.99 instead of $30. Let's estimate the production costs now. We know the game was developed for 37 months by a team of maximum 75 people. Let's assume that in the first half of development time, only a third of this team size was used. If we assume an average yearly salary of 75,000 euros in California, please educate me if this is completely unrealistic. Additional labor costs. About 150,000 euros hardware costs, 550,000 euros office rent and engine fees of about 6 million euros, plus a marketing budget of nearly 24 million euros, remember the 14%, which we assume comes solely from the publisher's pocket, then we have a total production cost of a bit over 44 million euros. Now for the net revenue. Take-Two published that they earned 131 million euro net revenue until March 2020. In September, the first DLC launched, and in October, Steam and GOG were allowed to sell the title. When the game was launched on Steam, you can see a big spike in concurrent users that ebbs down to a more or less flat line, which is normal for an RPG with limited replayability. So most of the revenue comes on launch and then again spikes again at launch of the DLC. If we assume 300,000 Steam customers, 40% of whom paid a price reduced during a sale, we assume that, then remove the taxes, chargebacks, and Steam fees, and estimate additional sales coming from GOG, Xbox, and PlayStation, then we can estimate an additional 9.2 million euros net revenue. Together, the net revenue is 140 million euros. Keep in mind, I am estimating conservatively, and we are also missing a few months of data, so this is probably more, but if you have more info, please post it in the comments. I would like to improve my estimation model. Next, revenue minus expenses is a profit of 101 million euros. No matter the distribution of marketing costs and revenue share between developer and publisher, this was a nice success story. A very nice success story. Microsoft bought Obsidian a bit too late to profit from The Outer Worlds, and Take-Two made a nice sum of money. In addition, the developers proved their worth towards their new Microsoft family. I expect that this increased the trust in Obsidian even more, and that they will be developing awesome RPGs in the foreseeable future. That's it about the business side. A nice detail that I found was the fan kit from Obsidian's game page. It doesn't only list wallpapers and ringtones, but also a detailed artwork aimed at cosplayers, so they can better build their own versions of Ellie or Marauder. Great fan service. That's it for today. If you want to build successful RPGs, look at how Obsidian does it. Adapt this to fit your own budget and team size, and shoot for the stars. Good evening.